Before I start this video, a little quiz. All I want you to do is to guess where this English speaker is from.
Star. Star. Darn. Darn. Blart. Blart. Crazy. Crazy. Nurse. Nurse. Curse. Curse.
I'll give the answer later, but first, let's get to grips with one of my absolute favourite vowels, in English at least. Of course, I don't like it because it's good or bad, but because it's fascinating. That said, it does have a fairly boring aspect. Now take a listen to this speaker.
Going, 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 going.
For this word, I think this would be a reasonable transcription. Let's hear the word in context.
You're gonna start visualizing yourself going to those places. Going into a 5 years dream list, going to that weird workout class. I was like visualizing myself going to all of these places.
As I'm sure many of you can tell, this speaker is Australian. And Australia's best known dictionary, the Macquarie, uses this transcription for the word in question. That's certainly less accurate than mine. This symbol would be phonetically correct for the vowel in Scotland. Where did they go? Our Australian speaker begins the diphthong with a far more open quality.
Go, 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 go.
And we see her lips starting to round there for the glide portion of the diphthong. Now, there's no good reason in Australian or any other accent of English to transcribe this kind of glide with the symbol for the checked vowel uh, as in Australian good and book. Unfortunately, most dictionaries do this, but it completely violates the generalisation that English doesn't end words in uh or any of the other checked vowels. That's why they're called checked. They have to be followed by a consonant. We have words like good and book, but no words like go and bo. The International Phonetic Alphabet has a perfectly good glide symbol, which linguists have been using for diphthongs like this since before the IPA. And we use it in the dictionary I co-edit, Cube. I cover all this in my video on why these symbols are all wrong. Using the glide symbol for this diphthong glide also makes it easy to see how the word koala, which Macquarie transcribes like this, transformed so easily through the weakening of the first syllable into the more common Australian pronunciation koala. This speaker's pronunciation of going isn't all that different from mine, or for that matter, from the kinds you get in general American. But if you want to show the differences of the starting quality in these various accents, you could do it like this. Going, going, going. Knowing, knowing, knowing. Showing, showing, showing. So far, so not particularly interesting. But notice in all of these words, the diphthong we're discussing is followed by another vowel. It's when there isn't a following vowel that things start to get interesting. The diphthong we're discussing, the one in words like go and know and show, is known to phonetics people as the goat vowel. And when it isn't followed immediately by another vowel, Australians pronounce it differently. Specifically, they change the glide part. Instead of the tongue body gliding back and up, as it does in the W glide, it glides somewhere else. For many Australians in what we can call the general Australian accent type, the glide is not so much up and back as up and forward. At the same time, as in W, the lips become somewhat rounded. In other words, it's more like the glide French has at the start of its number 8, 8. Here, courtesy of the University of Glasgow, we have an MRI video of a backward glide and an ultrasound video of a forward glide. This means that instead of go, as in going, we get something more like go. Some people like to transcribe the front glide with a vowel symbol, like this, but it's not a vowel, it's a glide. And it's perhaps worth pointing out that you can't really show the distinctiveness of the Australian type front glide on a tongue quadrilateral because it ignores the lips. So for example, I and R would look the same. To show the difference, you need an auditory acoustic vowel chart, where if two things sound different, they look different.
I. 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 I.
A more forward-moving goat vowel isn't restricted to Australia. You can hear it in New Zealand, and I hear it quite commonly in the south of England, where it can sound pretty Australian.
I really don't have a desire to. I really don't have a desire to.
In fact, across various accents of English, we can find speakers fronting either the first element or the glide of the goat vowel, or both.
You was everything that I hoped for you to be.
So Australia's forward-moving glide isn't all that special. The real reason the Aussie goat vowel is such a favourite of mine is what's happening to it in the speech of many younger speakers. For many younger Australians, the glide in the goat diphthong is becoming, or has become, rotacised, or R-coloured. Specifically, the vowel glides into what we can call a bunched R. In other words, not so much R as R. Backing up a bit, the characteristic English R sound can be articulated in two main ways. One has the tongue body relatively low in the mouth and the tip of the tongue curled up. The other has the tongue body bunched up, more like a typical vowel. And this, more or less, is what the new Australian goat is gliding to or towards. This bunched R goes under various names. Bunched R, molar R, domal R, braced R. If you go looking on Wikipedia, you'll find phonetic alphabet soup, with the bunched R described as a voiced, labialised, pharyngealised, retroflexified, velar approximant. Anyway, the bunched R is not necessarily velar, it's often more palatal. And it's not always pharyngealised, which means produced with throat constriction. Many phoneticians can only think in terms of articulation, but it's always worth reminding ourselves that in speech, the main thing is not to perform some particular articulation, but to make the right sound. And these radically different articulations are different ways of creating the distinctive rotacized sound, which I'll explain later. So I'm going to ignore the alphabet soup and just use the symbol recommended on the extended IPA chart, namely the normal English upside down R symbol plus dots for centralisation. You can also show the lip rounding if you want, but here for simplicity's sake, I won't bother. And now let's go back to the quiz at the start of the video, where I asked you where you thought the speaker was from. I would have answered somewhere in North America, but I have a terrible confession to make. I showed you these words, but I never actually claimed that these were the words the speaker was saying. In fact, the speaker is the same young Australian we were listening to before, and these words all contain her R-coloured goat diphthong. For example, this isn't the word star.
Star.
It's the word stone, with the final N cut off.
It isn't set in star and star and star
and. And this isn't the word darn.
Darn.
It's the word zone.
If you jump right into your panic zone.
Darn. Darn.
This isn't the word blur.
Blur.
It's the word below.
I have that linked up here and down below.
Blur. Blur.
This isn't the word crazy.
Crazy.
It's the word cozy.
The things that, like, you're cozy, you're content doing. Cozy, cozy.
This isn't the word nurse.
Nurse.
It's from know someone.
An opportunity for you to get to know someone.
Nurse, nurse.
And this isn't the word cars.
Cars.
It's the word coast.
By going to women in business meetups on the Gold Coast. Coast, coast.
Just compare this American speaker demonstrating the American bunched R with our Australian speaker producing her goat vowel.
R.
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 This R coloration has already made a splash in social media. It was actually a meme on TikTok a couple of years ago in reaction to an Australian TV series about mermaids called H2R, where supposedly a common expression was R-NAR.
Could you just say the word no?
Oh.
We just think it's so adorable.
No, that's funny.
Yeah, it's so adorable. We just think it's really cute the way you guys
so
say
cute.
It.
So cute. Australians don't really say the word.
Just
the
one
way you
teeny
think
little time to say it, please.
The way I speak without people making
no,
fun
not
of my accent.
Funny.
It's really, I'm rather self-conscious
NAUR.
About it. Could you stop?
No!
Yes!
Oh, no.
Of course, not all young Australians have gone that far, but we can hear the roticised goat to one degree or another from a lot of younger Australians. This sounds rather like an American guard.
Goat, goat, goat.
But it's the guy from Aussie English saying go down.
Go down to the comments, go down to the comments.
And listen to his vowel in no here.
I don't know, I don't know, no, r.
If this was an American speaker, I'd think they were saying turtle.
Turtle, turtle.
But of course it's an Australian saying total.
A three-part series that runs for a total of 7 hours, 48 minutes. In my last video, I discussed my hopes for The Beatles Get Back.
You can hear that pharyngealization or throat constriction that sometimes accompanies Bunched R.
I discuss my hopes for The Beatles Get Back.
Hopes.
There's also audible throat constriction in his Price diphthong, at least in this clip.
And quite famously, quite.
So we have this lovely phenomenon of R coloration where there's no historic trace whatsoever of a R consonant. This makes it quite different from the so-called intrusive R, as in law and order and vanilla rice, which is also found in Australia as it is in England.
A good idea is to really look at your vision. So draw a little cloud.
That phenomenon arises from words without historic R becoming phonetically merged with words that have historic R. For example, law merging in my accent with law, spa with spa, and stella merging with stella. The places where you find these two phenomena are the exact opposite of each other. So-called intrusive R only occurs directly before a vowel, law enforcement being pronounced the same as law enforcement. But directly before a vowel is precisely where we don't get the more interesting kinds of Australian goat vowel, because before a vowel we have the boring old W glide instead, as in going. This of course means there's an interaction with horrid attack. If a speaker goes directly from goat to a following vowel, we get the boring W glide, go ahead.
Go ahead and message a bunch of people.
But if the speaker puts hard attack on the following vowel, in other words, inserts an intervening glottal stop, then we get the more interesting variants. Now for goodness sake, don't believe the nonsense of so-called linking W, or linking Y for that matter, which don't exist in Australia, Britain, America or anywhere else, despite what YouTube videos, textbooks and even academic articles might tell you. The W in going and go ahead is the glide that's in the diphthong and is not in any way an extra inserted sound. Nobody ever inserts a W between Australian R or R and a following vowel. That would give you going or garwahead. No Australian has ever said karwala. To end, you might be wondering how this wonderful R-coloured goat vowel came to be if there's no historic R consonant. Well, again, you can't explain it with the old tongue quadrilateral, which not only ignores the lips, but can't even show a bunched tongue R. On the other hand, the explanation is quite simple in terms of actual sound. As I described in my video about the auditory acoustic vowel space, we usually plot it in two dimensions, corresponding to the two lowest and most important resonances of the vocal tract. That suffices to differentiate most vowels. For example, a French, German, Chinese type U vowel would be about here. Now, I ended that video by showing how the vowel space can easily be made three-dimensional by including the third highest vocal tract resonance, F3. And this three-dimensional vowel space will show, for example, how that French type U is lower than E in the F3 dimension. Now remember that the general Australian goat vowel has that French-style glide towards that kind of vowel. And as I showed right at the end of the vowel space video, R coloration involves lowering that F3 even further, whether it's produced with a curled tongue or a bunched tongue. So the progressive or fashionable younger Australians are just pushing the goat vowel's glide trajectory further down under. They're taking the general Australian goat diphthong and making it even more Aussie. Australian vowels are fascinating, and there's definitely more to be said about them and how they're often misanalysed. But that's for another video.